Wisdom, the final frontier to true knowledge. Welcome to Wisdom Trek, where our mission is to create a legacy of wisdom, to seek out discernment and insights, to boldly grow where few have chosen to grow before. Hello, my friend. I am Guthrie Chamberlain, your captain on our journey to increase wisdom and create a living legacy. Thank you for joining us today as we explore wisdom on our second millennium of podcast. This is day 1506 of our trek, and it is Worldview Wednesday. Creating a biblical worldview is essential to have a proper perspective on today's current events. To establish a biblical worldview, you must have a proper understanding of God and His Word. This week on our Worldview Wednesdays episode, we will continue to study based on a course I've recently completed, taught by Dr. Michael S. Heiser. Our study is entitled Sons and Daughters of God, Believer's Identity, Calling, and Destiny. Throughout this multi-week course, we have demonstrated that the Old Testament, Sons of God and Holy One, refers to supernatural beings whose Father is God and who work to carry out God's will, and that His divine family was present before humanity. By fully engaging the biblical texts such as Psalm 82, Psalm 89, and Deuteronomy chapter 32, verses 8 and 9, our study shows that this divine family functions as a template for God's human family. God desires of humans, as His imagers, to participate in His counsel. This study addresses issues such as polytheism, the nature of little g gods, and Yahweh's uniqueness. This study applies insights to the New Testament text to show how the metaphor of being in God's family informs our sense of identity and mission as believers. So today we'll return to the topic of the family of imagers, segment number 28, Believers as Family Participants, part 2. 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 and 2 is perhaps a key passage in tying these ideas together, and I've alluded to it several times already. John writes, "See how very much our Father loves us, for He calls us His children, and that is what we are. But the people of this world don't recognize that we are God's children because they don't know Him. Dear friends, we are already God's children, but He has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we will know that we will be like Him, for we shall see Him as He really is." This is a sense of being grafted back into His family. Now, in one sense, every human being is a child of God, and Paul alludes to this in his sermon in Acts chapter 17. God is the common creator. We understand that, but John is talking about something different here, especially post-fall, because family means participation. We are to be grafted back into the family, and the family, of course, includes the idea of participation, being in concert with God's will and helping God carry out His will. It's a different kind of relationship, but I think the kind of things we've been talking about here helps us to understand John's language instead of what Paul says in Acts chapter 17 a little bit better. Because unless you are a believer, you're not going to be able to be working in concert with God, again, carrying out His will, participating in His program. That is the original intent. It wasn't just to have humans there on earth back in Genesis chapter 1. As soon as God created us, the idea was to be with Him. We were to be united with Him in His blended family, His divine family that already existed, and together with His earthly family, to be in a place where heaven had come to earth. Heaven intersects with the earth in Eden, to overspread across the entire planet, to be working as one unit, one business, whatever metaphor helps here, be working together toward a common goal. And we see in these passages that Jesus restores a relationship. We cannot be part of His family when people are estranged from God, so Jesus brings us back into this relationship. We are, even in a greater sense, in the initially intended purpose, we are siblings, we are co-workers. John says this is what we are now. Those of us who are believers, but even more so, we will be even transcending that which we experience now. It goes back to the concept of already, but not yet. So we're in this already, but not yet sort of mode, that many of the other things in biblical theology are when it comes to the believer. We get a foretaste of what things were intended to be, ultimately, what will be. Of course, in the ultimate sense, we are united with Christ. We will be living with Him back in the kingdom in the new earth, the new Eden, the global Eden. Everything will come full circle. So again, the Old Testament context helps us to grasp this just a little bit better. We will be given the authority to be the children of God. John also wrote in his gospel in John chapter 1, verse 12, "But to all who believe in him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God." We have the authority to take this title. It's more than the concept, "Oh, I just exist, I'm a human being, God made me, so therefore I'm a child of God." No, this is something different. This is being brought back into the family to accomplish the original mandate and work with Jesus side by side, as it were, to be his spiritual sibling, his co-laborer sibling, not just the fact that we exist. So this language, to be correctly understood, needs to be read in the context of Genesis chapter 1. God's original intention for creating human imagers to align with his non-human imagers in a place where heaven and earth meet. This is going back and addressing the rebellion at Babel. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, Peter comments that the believers share in his divine nature. And he says, "And because of his glory and excellence, he has given us great and precious promises. These are the promises that enable you to share his divine nature and escape the world's corruption caused by human desires." We're already in that category, according to Peter. But again, we're progressively being transformed into the image of his son, as Paul says. We're becoming more like the ultimate imager, and ultimately, that process will reach its climax, glorification. In John chapter 11, verses 51 and 52, Caiaphas' prophecy, his sort of accidental prophecy, was about Jesus, and this is what is said about Caiaphas. "He did not say this on his own as the high priest at that time. He was led to prophesy that Jesus would die for the entire nation, and not only for that nation, but to bring together and unite all the children of God scattered around the world." Now this is important, especially if you're thinking like a Jew. The language would force you to go back to the Old Testament and do some thinking. If you were a Jew and had accepted Christ as the Messiah, as the Savior, his work was not just for the nation of Israel only, but it was so that everyone, all who believe, regardless of where they are, scattered among the nations, would be gathered into the one family of the children of God. It's sort of rolling back not only the Eden problem, the fall, the estrangement from God in general, it is also the rolling back of what resulted because of the rebellion of Babel, when the nations are divided and allotted to the lesser sons of God. This son of God, the unique son of God, the monogamous son of God, because he became the incarnate and died on the cross. Part of that mission was to erase the distinctions and to bring the nations back into the fold. Jesus is the seed that Paul was talking about, referencing Genesis chapter 12, and through the seed of Abraham, all the nations would be blessed. It is the re-inheritance of Eden. All of these ideas are important. They are threads or part of a matrix of ideas with deep roots in the Old Testament. Romans chapter 8, verses 16 and 17, we read this, "For his spirit joins with our spirits to affirm that we are God's children. And since we are his children, we are his heirs. In fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But if we are to share in his glory, we must also share in his sufferings." Our status isn't just that we believe, and now that we're going to have eternal life. That is true, but the inheritance language is essential. What are we inheriting? We're inheriting what God originally intended for us, the global Eden, the new earth. Read in the context of the Old Testament. This is another example where God looks at believers differently. We had been estranged because of rebellion, because of the fall. He looks at us now as family members. Everything has come full circle once more. The passages we reviewed today are very clear passages. There are a few other things that we read in the New Testament that make a subtle connection between Jesus, believers, the supernatural family of God, this thing that we call the divine council within Psalm 82, and the rule of Eden again, the original plan. We want to look at a few of these less apparent passages next week in our Worldview Wednesday episode. And that will finish our study for this week on Worldview Wednesday. Next week, we will finish the course, and we will cover part 3 of Believers as Family Participants. Tomorrow, we will enjoy a 3-minute humor nugget that will provide you with a bit of cheer, which will help you to lighten up and live a rich and satisfying life. So encourage your friends and family to join us, and then come along with us tomorrow for another day of Wisdom Trek, Creating a Legacy. If you'd like to listen to any of our past 1,505 tracks or read the Wisdom Journal, they are all available at wisdom-track.com. I encourage you to subscribe to Wisdom Trek on your favorite podcast player so that each day's trek will be downloaded to you automatically. And thank you so much for allowing me to be your guide, your mentor, but most importantly, I am your friend as I serve you through the Wisdom Trek podcast and journal each day. And as we take this trek of life together, let us always live abundantly, love unconditionally, listen intentionally, learn continuously, lend to others generously, lead with integrity, and leave a living legacy each day. I am Guthrie Chamberlain, reminding you to keep moving forward, enjoy your journey, and create a great day every day. See you tomorrow.